got something to munch on.
What, are you fucking kidding me? You know, most guys I know would be happy to get rid of their wife.
I try to explain the realities here. This guy's as stubborn as a fucking mule. He says it's principle. I think we gotta, you know, that's why we called you.
Look, I promised to fight him or I wouldn't.
Nah, I didn't know what else to do.
You know, you're a stupid motherfucker, you know that?
I've heard it said.
What, are you proud of it?
You kill me, and a dark cloud goes over Shlomo's house. Either way, there'll be no get unless restitution is made.
You really would let me kill you, wouldn't you, you sick fuck?
You ever heard of the Masada? For 2 years, 900 Jews held their own against 15,000 Roman soldiers. They chose death before enslavement. And the Romans, where are they now?
You're looking at them, asshole.
Friends, welcome to the Guest Behemoth Podcast. It's good to be back. Boy, do we have a lot of news coming up in this episode, so stay tuned. We'll be right back.
hour. Here is the news. A cure has been found for good old rocket life. Someone left their life behind in a plastic bag. Action-filled adventure.
Here is the news.
All the worst from the world convention.
Yes, we are back, and I've got a few things I want to talk about, and we're going to scoot over to the news desk here in a minute. I recently got a digital recorder, which also can be used as an audio interface with the computer, and it's a much better quality microphone. Shall we say? It actually has a wind guard on it. So, however, I'm experiencing technical difficulties with that little gadget, so I'm still using the old Guest Behemoth mic here. So you're going to hear me breathing and popping my peas and all that. Yeah, the old jalopy here has problems with USB devices, and the first time that I plugged this in and actually used it to record, the software that I create these podcasts on crashed, or hung, if you will, which happens with certain USB devices on the old jalopy. So I'm not sure if we're going to be able to iron that out, but I did want to do an episode tonight, so fuck it, we're using the old microphone, just in case. You know, I would hate to have almost an entire episode and have the software crash before I have a chance to save it. I just don't want to take that chance. So, what's in the news? Something popped up today. Very interesting. Oh, a confirmation, if you will. If you listen to a few episodes back in November, I guess it's episode number 127, when the Jerry Sandusky scandal first broke. I just give out my personal thoughts and reflections on that stuff. And I think I mentioned in that episode about things that I've heard about prominent officials in the state college area participating in cult-like activities that involve child abuse and such things. And today, this bit of news popped up. Excuse me. And I'm not sure how long it's going to be up, but I'm going to read this article to you. Jury awards $16.5 million in state college suit. A jury awarded $16.5 million Thursday to a woman who said she was drugged with carbon dioxide and manipulated to believe she was raped by family members at the hands of a former state college psychologist. Her attorney, Bernard Cantorna, asked the jury to hold Julian Metter, 59, accountable for planting a horror story in the woman's mind while she was drugged with carbon dioxide. The jurors responded after 5 hours of deliberation, unanimously ordering Metter to pay what Cantorna said is the largest jury verdict in Centre County history. They clearly wanted to send a message that Dr. Metter is a danger to the public and anyone he might attempt to treat, Cantorna said. They wanted to make sure anybody and everybody could find this case and make sure he can never do this to anyone again. Metter, who had been in practice for 20 years, lost his license to practice psychology in June of 2009 when he pleaded guilty to fraudulently billing Medicare, according to the National Council Against Health Fraud. He was sentenced in February 2011 to serve 5 months in prison, followed by 2 years probation. Cantorna said Metter is free to continue treating people, just not as a psychologist, after his probation. When contacted Thursday night, Metter said he was saddened and disappointed by the jury's decision. He said he will appeal the verdict. "It was very surprising," Metter said. "Everyone with me who knows the woman and the situation really felt we brought forward a very accurate picture." Cantorna said his client was made to believe she was raped at the hands of her family and abused in cult-like rituals by prominent members of the community. Metter was accused in the civil lawsuit of creating those images and suggesting them as reality while the woman was drugged and in her most vulnerable state. "He took a woman who never had any history of this and made her relive the most horrific things one could imagine," Cantorna said Thursday during closing arguments in the 6-day civic trial. "He made her live it." The lawsuit alleged the woman suffered lasting emotional anguish as a result. It also stated she suffered a brain injury due to repeated exposures to a mixture of carbon dioxide and oxygen. This is the salient paragraph right here. Kimberly June testified via telephone that her patients said the cult... Wait a minute. Back here. "He called to the stand a therapist from Pittsburgh, formerly of State College, who testified Thursday she treated two separate patients who reported similar cult abuse in Centre County. Kimberly June testified via telephone that her patients said the cult included doctors, police officers, and a judge, operated in the 1960s, and performed torture, buried children in coffins, killed animals, and impregnated young women." Wow. So, that is the salient point of all this. I think that's the smoking gun. We have another witness who's had similar experiences with patients from this area. So, I told you so. Thank you.
he'll suffer like a lamb. Yeah, he'll suffer. Ring is holy, but his innocence is damned. Yeah, his innocence is damned. Child to his grave. Now he will wander pointlessly where no memories are saved. Our history.
That's kind of depressing, is it not? That was World of Skin, The Child's Right. I had to play that song after that disturbing story. And we will see if any more comes of it. Unfortunately, it looks like things are going to be very hush-hush and we're not going to have any more investigation into these activities. It appears that they don't really come to the conclusion whether these repressed memories were just mere hypnotic suggestion or based in reality. But yet they slap this psychologist with a $16.5 million settlement. Yeah. What the fuck is going on in this fucking county? I knew it all along. Well, I just hope somebody somewhere raises a big stink and these fucking animals get exposed for what they are. On to other things. What other things? Oh, Public Image has a new song. Yes, Public Image Limited, after about 20 years, have finally released a new song. And I grabbed this off the internet, an article where they actually play the song that has been released. So, I'm just going to play this little clip here from the UK. This is Public Image Limited.
Public Image Limited fans, first play anywhere of their first new material.
I was born in London. I am no vulture. This is my culture. The laws of nature. Explain us, and that's what makes us. We are the ageless.
this ocean. Not gotta be causing commotion. One drop, not follow the motion. Not got no proper emotion. One drop, all of this ocean. Get proper, follow the motion. Get proper, proper emotion. Not gotta be causing commotion.
First taste of their new material, 20 years on from their last batch. This will form part of an EP released for Record Store Day on April the 21st, but there is a new Public Image LP due in the summer, which will be called, we're told, This Is Public Image Limited. The new material recorded last year at a studio in the Cotswolds, and that particular track, One Drop, written about Lydon's experiences growing up in and around Finsbury Park. If you'd like to know more, John Lydon spoke to our own Matt Everett this morning on The Breakfast Show, where Andrew Collins is sitting in, and you can hear that up online, of course, bbc.co.uk/6music. Also, Public Image Limited added to the bill of our 10th anniversary shows that's down on the South Bank on the 16th of March, and there's more information on that as well at the website. But it's Public Image Limited, first play anywhere on the radio of that, their new single. That's called One Drop. 6music.
Yes, Behemoth Podcast. Free form music and comment.
Thank you.
was Yet May, Kill the Beast, and before that, Pylon, Volume. I feel a little bit mixed up here. Gosh, after that horrible story, bringing this sordid shit to light. Gosh, you know, it's... Do I want to play upbeat music? Hey, you got to focus on the positive. On the positive side, this stuff's being brought to light. May they be exposed. And I hope more victims of this abuse come forward. Let them be exposed. And speaking of that, another news story popped up today. It's actually an old story. I didn't realize this, but as I was just looking at it, I noticed that it was from June 8th of 2010. So this is like over a year and a half old, but I thought it was very pertinent. So here we go. I'm going to attempt to read this article again. Get your ears on. Psychiatrist of Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu commits suicide. Moshe Yatom, a prominent Israeli psychiatrist who successfully cured the most extreme forms of mental illness throughout a distinguished career, was found dead at his home in Tel Aviv yesterday from an apparent self-inflicted gunshot wound. A suicide note at his side explained that the Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, who has been his patient for the past 9 years, had sucked the life right out of me. Quote, "I can't take it anymore," wrote Yatom. "Robbery is redemption. Apartheid is freedom. Peace activists are terrorists. Murder is self-defense. Piracy is legality. Palestinians are Jordanians. Annexation is liberation. There's no end to his contradictions." Freud promised rationality would reign in the instinctual passions, but he never met Benjamin Netanyahu. This guy would say Gandhi invented brass knuckles. Psychiatrists are familiar with the human tendency to massage the truth to avoid confronting emotionally troubling material, but Yatom apparently was stunned at what he called the waterfall of lies gushing from his most illustrious patient. His personal diary details the steady disintegration of his once invincible personality under the barrage of self-serving rationalizations put forth by Netanyahu. "I'm completely shocked," said neighbor Yossi Bekor, whose family regularly vacationed with Yatom's family. Moshe was the epitome of the fully integrated personality and had cured dozens of schizophrenics before beginning his work on Benjamin Netanyahu. There was no outward indication that his case was any different from the others. But it was. Yatom grew increasingly depressed at his complete lack of progress in getting the Prime Minister to acknowledge reality, and he eventually suffered a series of strokes when attempting to grasp Netanyahu's thinking, which he characterized in one diary entry as a black hole of self-contradiction. The first of Yatom's strokes occurred when Netanyahu offered his opinion that the 9/11 attacks on Washington and New York were, quote, good. The second followed a session in which Netanyahu insisted that Iran and Nazi Germany were identical. And the third occurred after the Prime Minister declared Iran's nuclear energy program was a flying gas chamber and that all Jews everywhere lived permanently in Auschwitz. Yatom's efforts to calm Netanyahu's hysteria were extremely taxing emotionally and routinely ended in failure. Quote, "The alibi is always the same with him," complained another diary entry. "The Jews are on the verge of annihilation at the hands of the racist Goyim, and the only way to save the day is to carry out one final massacre." Yatom was apparently working on converting his diary into a book about the Netanyahu case. Several chapters of an unfinished manuscript entitled Psychotic on Steroids were found in his study. The excerpt below offers a rare glimpse at the inner workings of a prime minister's mind at the time, and reveals the daunting challenge Yotam faced in seeking to guide it to rationality. And it says here, Monday, March 8th, Bibi, that's Netanyahu's nickname, I don't know why, Bibi came by at 3 for his afternoon session. At 4 he refused to leave and claimed my house was actually his. Then he locked me in the basement overnight while he lavishly entertained his friends upstairs. When I tried to escape, he called me a terrorist and put me in shackles. I begged for mercy, but he said he could hardly grant it to someone who didn't exist. End quote. That's a real interesting story. Netanyahu, the psychotic, using doublespeak, rationalizations. Oh, yes, expose, coming to light. Oh, gosh, what can I play now? Boy, we got some real doozies today, that's for sure.
Just any crisis, please don't cry. It's just a personality crisis, please don't stop. Because I want a personality, don't a personality.
It was one morning when I woke up, and I found out that they'd signed some papers and that I was going to be kept in a bed owing to the state of my mind. And then I found out that the authorities had said that I'd got to have special food fed to me for my thoughts. And I think it's because I was going off my
head. Sunday from flood skies, 20,000 butterflies glorify my bed in deep room. Turn from hot to very cool, though it seems incredible, I could ride a bike around the moon. Position where I lie from the corner of my eye. Callous friends just pass me by. Doctor pays a visit every day. I keep asking for my death. They must think I'm going mad. Lift the blankets off my face quick before I suffocate. Trying hard to meditate. Tell the people what I see. Write a letter to the Queen, asking her if she can come to tea. Cherry Blossom Clinic, is there any truth in what they say? Cherry Blossom Clinic,
lock me in and throw the key away.
Up above, the sun is high. Like a tea tree in the sky, helicopter lands upon my bed. And some horses quickly fade, turning into lemonade. Probably feel better when I'm dead. Cherry Blossom Clinic, is there any truth in what they say?
Throw the key away.
That was The Move. Roy Wood and Jeff Lynne and the crew. Name of that was Cherry Blossom Clinic. Of course, we had the New York Dolls, Personality Crisis, Psychedelic Furs, We Love You. And we started out with Todd Rundgren, Temporary Sanity. Yeah, so... one thing I wanted to mention, because I was talking about this on my last episode. I got the Swans live album, okay? It is absolutely fucking amazing. It's beautiful. I was gobsmacked. I think it's the best special CD that Michael Girard has ever released. One of his special web-only CDs that he uses to raise money to record. This was released to help him fund the recording sessions for the new Swans studio album. However, and I really, really, really wanted to share a track from this album, but the insert had explicit admonishment from Mr. Girard asking to please, please not upload it on the internet anywhere. And because he specifically wanted this disc to belong to the people who bought it, who sent him the money so that he could finish recording the new album. And he said, this is yours, it belongs to you, please, please, please don't share this on the internet. And I have to abide by his wishes. There's even a track on the second disc where he once again says, it's really cool, the second disc, after all the live stuff is over, he just talks to us, talking about the new album and introducing and discussing the songs that he plays, which are just acoustic versions of songs that they are working for on the new album. And he reiterates it again, please do not upload this on the internet. So, abiding by Mr. Girard's wishes, I cannot share any of the Swans live album with you on this podcast, because this is the internet. However, if, you know, that doesn't mean I can't share it with you in person, so perhaps I'll come to your house for a listening party. But I can't stick this up on the internet. I'm not gonna be the asshole that does it. You know somebody's gonna do it. You know some dickhead that bought this disc is just gonna completely disrespect Michael Girard and stick it up on the internet anyways. But I'm not gonna be the asshole that does that. His music means a lot to me, and I respect his wishes. And I think, as I have said, this is like the best disc that he's ever put out. He's put out discs before to help raise money to record the new album. There was a live Angels of Light, which was really good, and various acoustic projects where he just goes through acoustic versions of songs that he's working on for the next album and all that. But this one really takes the cake. I mean, it's... holy shit, it is so good, man. And I'm so happy that it is mine. It is mine. It's not yours, it's mine. This is mine. Gosh, I could play that song. This is mine. Do you think you could handle that? We already played a World of Skin song. Maybe I should play This Is Mine. I don't know. People will tune out if I play that. It's just a little too harsh. Of course, we discuss some pretty brutal realities here. You know, we got the Prime Minister of Israel completely off his nut. You know, how Orwellian for this psycho, for this psychotic on steroids to be Prime Minister of Israel, where his own psychologist, who is an expert at curing people of the most extreme cases of mental illness, was completely worn down by how messed up this man is and killed himself. I mean, that is a really fucked up story, people. You really need to think about that. Aside from the expose, the smoking gun, about the satanic cultists that apparently were active back in the 60s. Boy, am I lucky. You know, I am so lucky that I escaped them, because I was a child back in the 60s. They could have buried me in the box, you know. Who fucking knows? It's disgusting. Anyways, I don't want to get negative. I don't want to get negative. But I had to share that. I had to share this stuff. Okay, we are nearing the end of the episode here, so I can stay at CD length. I don't want to keep it too long. So I'm going to play something. Pale Sketcher from the album Pale Sketches Demixed. That was the Gone version of Can I Go Now? That was a relief, was it not? That was very relieving. So I'm going to wrap it up, folks. I thank you very much for listening. Sorry this episode was kind of mixed up. Kind of messed up, but you know, that's the way it goes. So tune in next time for the Guest Behemoth podcast, and we'll rendezvous then. Peace.
Come back for help. Don't look at that as a defeat.
Well, she's part of that generation that grew up during the Depression. But the Depression to her was a trip to Six Flags.
There's that D word again. Stay with your mother.
Now that my father's dead, he's a saint. When he was alive, nothing. My dad was tough. He ran his own crew. A guy like that, and my mother wore him down to a little nub. He was a squeaking little gerbil when he died.
Quite a formidable maternal presence.
I gotta be honest with you, I'm not getting any satisfaction from my work either.
Why?
Well, because of Rico.
Is he your brother?
No. The Rico statutes?
Oh, of course. You know? Right.
You read the papers? You know the government's using electronic surveillance and various legal strategies to squeeze my business?
Do you have any qualms about how you actually make a living?
Yeah. I find I have to be the sad clown, laughing on the outside, crying on the inside. See, things are trending downward. Used to be a guy got pinched, he took his prison job no matter what. Everybody upheld the code of silence. Nowadays, no values. Guys today have no room for the penal experience. So everybody turns government witness. I feel exhausted just talking about it.
Well, with today's pharmacology, no one needs to suffer with feelings of exhaustion and depression.
Here we go. Here comes the Prozac.